Good morning, open source fans, and welcome to San Francisco, California. We are delighted to be coming to you from Chainguard Assemble today. My name's Savannah Peterson, honored to be joined by my new powerful wing woman, Jackie McGuire. Jackie, hey. Thanks so much for coming to talk security with me today.
I am so happy to be here, finally getting to do an event with my favorite HBIC.
Yes, yeah, baby. It's about time. Speaking of some of my favorite people, we have one of my favorite people in security sitting right to my left, Dustin Kirkland.
What?
Aww. Sometimes a co-analyst with me, always a VIP guest. Thank you for being here this morning.
Absolutely. This is going to be fun.
And you brought a friend, Matt Moore. Thank you for being here.
Thank you for having me.
I mean, technically, this is your boss, right? It's not just a friend. This is your boss.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
Yeah, okay.
Co-founder, board of directors, Chainguard.
This is
good
your
partner.
Show. Matt, what does it feel like to be here today with all of your community?
Surreal. I mean,
yeah.
You know, it was tremendous being up on stage and seeing, you know, all of, you know, the customers and prospects who were able to come out. And, yeah, I mean, every time coming to one of these events and just seeing all of these faces, it's, yeah, surreal.
You know, yeah, I mean, I noticed the energy. We were hanging out with the crew getting set up here beforehand. And as soon as everyone came out of the keynote, I mean, just this wave of enthusiasm and excitement. I know y'all got some really big announcements going on. Let's start off by talking about the Chainguard Software Factory. Something cool in my notes that I want to talk about that I'm sure Jackie's even more familiar with than I am is the notion of nano updates. Now, I was having this conversation just yesterday on the news desk about setting the bar low and clearing it often as we make this next transformation. Not to say that your goals shouldn't be huge, but if you're not taking baby steps, you're going to end up potentially making a mistake of spending a lot of money that you don't want to spend right now, or having some horrible security breach or something else that's fairly lethal. So Matt, I'm going to start with you. Talk to me about continuous nano updates.
Yeah, I mean, it really is, you know, almost a projection of the idea of continuous delivery, right? Like, you know, you look at the traditional model of consuming open source software where, you know, you sort of pretend for years at a time that nothing changes, and then a couple of years later, everything changes.
Yeah.
And so all of those things you were ignoring for all of that time all rushes in at once, and it all breaks you at once, and it basically takes out your organization trying to update it all. My favorite analogy for this, and I can take no credit for coming up with this, but is, you know, these tiny little updates are like brushing your teeth every day, right? Good hygiene, you take it a piece at a time, and everyone would rather do that than get a root canal every couple years, right?
Yes.
I don't think anyone would disagree with that.
I am obsessed with my oral hygiene, so the fact that you use this analogy, like, you are really speaking my OCD language right now. So thank you for that. Yeah.
But it did take me years to develop the hygiene habit, I will say. Having been a latchkey kid, to your point, I think it, like, you don't necessarily, because you don't see the benefits right away, it's hard to keep yourself going until you're like, oh, I haven't had a cavity filled in 4 or 5 years. That's probably not a coincidence.
I feel my teeth I need to go to the dentist right now. This is exactly how I wanted to start my Tuesday morning.
She's going to be in the bathroom with a water pick.
Yeah. Maybe that's Chainguard's next product, a night guard.
Yeah. Maybe that's your sweat.
Or a grill.
A grill?
Custom grills.
Yes.
Assemble.
Yes. Could you have
not going to lie, love where this conversation, we're off to a great start today, folks. I hope you're all ready. Buckle up your seatbelts, because this is not going to be a boring show. Beyond it being an everyday habit that's easier to maintain than getting a root canal, this also makes it faster to be able to develop, correct? Dustin, tell me a little bit about that.
Yeah, I mean, it's those nano updates. It's about this constant stream of always be upgrading, as opposed to putting them off for months and months, if not years, which is the traditional distro model of wait every 2 or 3 years and then go through a massive upgrade. And, you know, I think there's one segment of developers that might have looked at that and said, well, everything's stable and I don't want to change anything, I don't want to move anything, everything just works. And that's true up until a point, but what you've actually accumulated is years and years of tech debt, years and years of changes, and what we're all here today talking about is the security vulnerabilities that you've also accumulated. You can't get rid of some of those until you do a major upgrade. And that major upgrade is, it's painful. It's a root canal. It's, you know, the difference between stubbing your toe every day, or breaking your leg, you know, once every 2 years and being in rehab for 9 months.
We're really killing it on the analogy again.
Let's keep going.
Jackie, I'm curious, as an analyst, are you seeing this notion of nano updates coming across as more ubiquitous? Is this a chain guard leading the front here? What's going on?
Yeah, I think most people working in security wish it was ubiquitous, but I think we're at this interesting place where we've kind of, security and IT are merging to a certain extent, and I think to your point, IT has always been a somewhat steady state. It's like, we want to maintain, we want to monitor, and so I think, you know, ChainGuard is really on the forefront in that it's understanding what little updates are going to do and the risk that they pose is a significantly different process than understanding a major update. And that's I think, you know, doing little, if you've ever owned a house, here's another analogy, like painting a room every couple months, you know, slowly upgrading the house is a lot easier than, oh, we need to rip out the plumbing. Now we need to redo all of the plumbing. And so,
But let's double down on the benefits. I mean, it's a constant flow of new features, new enablement. It's the types of things that cutting-edge developers need and want if they're, you know, trying to write applications at the cutting edge. Maybe it's a latest and greatest tool chain, compiler flags. It could be new Python or compiler libraries, Java libraries, all of that. You need latest and greatest as a developer, or else you're waiting and not able to do what you're trying to do.
Well, and to keep yourself, you know, current as well. So I think one of the other things that happens when companies don't keep their software updated is that all of their developers also miss out, right? Because then they're also having to go through this massive lift of, great, now I have to learn all of these new features. It's basically like going to a 0.5 operating system versus if you're just continually doing it, you as a person, as a security engineer, are also continually building your skills, which will keep you from getting stuck in a job you don't want to be stuck in because you're several releases behind.
I think one of the counterintuitive things, right, is it can help with stability, right? Where, like, never changing anything, you know, is, you know, okay, it's going to maintain a certain known baseline. You know, that if you roll out software every 3 months, right, there's a whole wad of changes, and when something breaks, you don't know which of those changes broke things, right? And so if you're doing this, these constant little updates, it's much easier to figure out which of the little small changes broke you and, you know, roll that back. And so one of the things we encourage our customers to do as they're picking up these updates is implement good change management practices where, you know, while we are making those available to them, they're in total control of how quickly they pick them up and run them through their own qualification processes in order to roll them out into their systems.
How's the response been there? Because you can only, you know, you can lead a horse to water, so to speak, and try and illustrate best practices. But I'm curious, that it is a shift in mindset, particularly for some of these legacy system, archaic company stacks that live out there. So what are you hearing, Dustin?
It's kind of all over the board, Savannah. There are definitely developers, directors of engineering, platform engineers that come to us and say, oh my God, this is what we've been wanting, we've been needing all along. You know, we're not getting what we need out of other distros that only release every 2 or 3 years. To get that, we're having to go to some unsupported, non-enterprise distro, a bleeding edge, or rolling distro.
Right.
And those are, you know, it's quite receptive and it's a great match. We do end up, and you know, I'll be frank and say, we do end up with some customers that have trouble adapting to that speed and that velocity up front until they see the benefits. When they see the benefits, the completely clean vulnerability scans, developers who are actually really happy with being able to run, have libraries and dependencies that are years ahead of, you know, those getting delivered in another distro. It takes a little bit to cross that chasm, but time and time again, and we've got 150 customers here today represented, time and time again, you know, they've you know, come around and seen how powerful this can be and transformative it can be.
It's teaching someone the benefits of brushing your teeth.
Yeah. Matt, what do you...
So you feel like dentists. Actually, that's ChainGuard, AKA your dental team.
So what do you think is the... Do you see as the top one or two things that prevents companies from adopting an accelerated release? And how do you... So what do you think is different about ChainGuard? Not just... I hear that you see the benefits, but What do you think is the real shift that your customers, beyond just the getting used to the process, that what keeps them from doing this in the first place? Is it the inertia of we've always done it this way? Is it the explaining the benefits? I assume it's across the board, but you guys are doing something correctly, because I'm reading about people using ChainGuard for kind of non-traditional things. One of my past lives, I built a very large music festival in a video game with lots of servers, and I was just reading today about your CVE-less servers available for this video game. So what are you guys doing that is breaking that inertia?
I would say, to the previous point, one of those things is educating folks. And we have, a very large customer success organization that works with our customers to go on site and help them, train the trainers in some cases of very large customers, but, working with users to understand, how to implement things properly. I think one of the other ones, which is also a very reasonable thing, is some of our customers have very long production freezes. I think one that was interesting that I hadn't heard of before, because I haven't worked in healthcare software, is open enrollment, right? Yeah. Freezing production during that period of time. And so this is why we built some of these features, like EUL grace period, which we talked about in the keynote, to extend the lifespan of certain pieces of older software to give those customers a grace period. It's not extended support, but it's a grace period to enable folks to bridge those sorts of gaps, which are very reasonable things, to not want to destabilize their production environment, but still maintain that low CV posture.
Yeah, I think what I would add is that this concept of a rolling distro, we didn't invent that. That's actually been around in most other Linux distros. There is some Devel or Next or testing. Debian's got a couple of different ways of doing it. Fedora, Rawhide, SUSE, Tumbleweed, Ubuntu Devel. But none of those are intended to be run in production.
Right?
All of those are feeders into this other stable thing that those distros, release as an LTS, as a versioned thing, supported for some period of time. We've actually flipped that on its head and said, no, we're only going to have a rolling distro. We are going to test the heck out of it, and that's the factory part of what we're doing on the back end is the quality assurance around every compiler, every package, every library, assembling that into images, running those images in isolation and then as part of a whole, and then constantly releasing that every day, all day, every day, and calling that is our enterprise-supported product. That's really what's different.
It makes a lot of sense, and you've been doing this. Better Way to Build started 10 years ago. You and I always talk about the Kubernetes 10-year anniversary in containers a lot, which is actually relevant here as well. Matt, talk to me. You rolled that out a decade ago. Are we where you thought we would be 10 years later?
It's really interesting. Someday I'm going to change my story. But like Dan talked about a lot of these.
Every day is a new day to rewrite
as
your
long
story,
as you
Matt.
Win. History's written by the victors. You can say whatever you want as long as you win.
A lot of these projects that, we're us working on parts of this problem that really, our current product is a culmination of a lot of these things. Someday we'll tell this as if it was a master plan where we were sort of nibbling around the edges of this, figuring out how we were going to do it. And then we started ChainGuard and brought them all together and did it. But really, we were just recognizing problems and, working on, solving piece by piece by piece. And as Dan said, right, like I think people were struggling to put together a lot of those things. And so, our master plan unfolded and we brought them all together.
And here we are today in a room full of smiling faces.
Yeah. So, I will say when I gave that distroless talk, people looked at me like I was an alien. They didn't get the idea of distro.
I was kind of wondering about that because you would have been an early mover in that environment.
It was in the early days of even CVE scanning for container images. People loved their Docker files. They were like, why?
That's
why would I?
Docker time, right? Oh, now, yeah. Straight up.
Yeah. Why would I stop building things the way I'm building them now? And I think another surreal moment for me was going from that, people looking at me like I was an alien trying to take away their fun little toys, to being in the audience at KubeCon. And I remember Liz Rice on stage, I think at the time she was chair of the technical oversight committee. She was just, you know, throwing around the word distro list, like everyone in the room should know what it was. And I was like, that's really funny. We've come a long way, right?
Well,
and
you knew, you were in on the joke. That was an if you know, you know. It's perfect.
I didn't know Matt at the time, and I would have been a competitor at the time, but I do remember hearing it and thinking, man, that's rude.
Really?
Cool, coming from a distro, yeah. It's like, distro list, that's a rude thing to say.
So rude. Yeah. Wow, spoken like a true open source community, man. You actually have emotions and feelings when it comes to technology.
What do you know?
What is this?
What do you know?
What is this? Are we in the empathetic side of this business? I love to hear it. Let's talk about now how we're moving forward. Chainguard Factory, now you're able to automate and add to that inventory, probably largely because of your strategy here. What's coming next? Matt, I'll start with you since you started this whole game 10 years ago.
Yeah, what's 10 years from now? I need to rebalance my 401k.
Amen to that, sis.
I think one of the things I like to point back to is, you know, just a North Star is, you know, our mission is to be the safe source for open source. And so there's two really easy dimensions to look at there. More open source, and you know, we talked about more form factors for open source today. We're always expanding our catalog of open source. The other thing is more safety, right? Like, there's never going to be an end to the lengths that, you know, attackers will go to. As we make, you know, as Dan said, they pick the easiest path in, and as we make it harder to attack certain paths, they will find, you know, that it's like a bolt of lightning following the path of least resistance, right? We need to continuously identify what those paths are and eliminate them. And it's just going to become a game of ratcheting it up over and over and over. So more security, more safety.
I love that. We're here for all of the more. Dustin, I'm going to phrase the question slightly differently to you because I know I can always push you a little bit further.
Let's see what you got.
Yeah. What are you looking forward to being able to give to your customers and the community moving forward that maybe you're not quite as able to give to them today?
Well, you know, I think Dan framed the direction we've taken ChainGuard in terms of, you know, we started with a foothold in a very important place, hardening the containers that run inside of every Kubernetes. We've been entrusted with that piece of the puzzle by, you know, 150 plus customers at tremendous scale, some incredible brands, at some of the world's biggest logos. But then going both below that and running at the virtual machine layer, providing that secure host as well, and then that library layer, and being able to do that actually horizontally across not just ChainGuard OS, but potentially other operating systems as well. That's a lot that I think a customer can take advantage of from ChainGuard and really demonstrate that they've moved, truly moved the needle in terms of removing vulnerabilities from an attacker's access.
It's that ecosystem play, really. It's broadening the little hug you're able to give all of your customers is what I just heard there. Last question for this interview, because this has been fantastic. Matt, what is the best and worst part of working with Dustin?
Start with the worst.
Oh, God.
Come on, this is a conference.
That was not on the script.
That was not on the pre-approved questions.
I mean, you know, I was one of the folks who started DistroLess because I had, you know, very little distro expertise, and Dustin is just a wealth of distro expertise, you know, and has been a talent magnet for us and has, you know, hired an amazing team.
I knew this was going to end well for you. You looked at me dirty, but you know I'm always teeing it up for the real moment.
All right, now the tea.
Yeah.
The worst thing, we both talk a lot. Yeah.
We're not very productive.
I mean, you know, you get. I joke with folks, if you get me started, I can talk all day, and we are cut from the same cloth there. People actually confuse us a surprising amount, too. People will come up to me and be like, oh, hey, Dustin, must be the beard.
That's why I grew my hair out.
I was thinking, yeah, you know, you got to get those locks a little longer to go in full Dustin vibes. I love it. Thank you both. Matt Moore, Dustin Kirkland, really appreciate you starting the day off right with us.
Yeah, thanks for having us.
And Jack and McGuire, we are going to have the best day ever.
I am so excited.
Me too, my dear, me too. I hope all of you are excited wherever you may be tuning in. We're here in San Francisco, California at ChainGuard Assemble. My name's Savannah Peterson. You're watching theCUBE, the leading source for enterprise tech news.
first cube? Have you done one before?
I may have done one.
Yeah, at Google?